Howdy, y'all. Today, we're going to be taking a look at the problems with elections in the United States. Specifically, we'll be diving into how both the electoral system itself and the ways in which elections are administered have been constructed throughout American history and into the modern day to erase the impact of African Americans, steal their votes, and perpetuate their subjugation. To understand how America's electoral system screws over Black Americans, we first need to understand how elections work in the US. Civics is fairly boring, so I'm going to try to make this part quick. Presidential elections in the US don't function the same as in any other democracy. Unlike other countries, where the president is determined by which candidate receives the most votes, the US runs on a system called the Electoral College. Essentially, what this system entails is that when you vote for president, you're not actually voting for the president directly, but instead you're advising electors, who are the people that actually vote for the president. A bit after the election, the electors will meet in their states, cast their ballots, and send them to DC to be counted. It's sort of like Eurovision for absolute nerds. Now, the amount of electors for each state is determined by how many representatives and senators the state has put together, with Washington, D.C. being allotted 3, despite not having any senators. Additionally, one of the key aspects of this system is what is called first-past-the-post voting. This means that whichever candidate wins a state's popular vote will receive all of that state's electoral votes, regardless of their margin of victory. First-past-the-post is not strictly required for this system, and in fact, a couple states allot their electoral votes proportionally to the popular vote. But they're the exception to the rule. The final notable thing about this system is what are called faithless electors. These are electors who vote for a different candidate than the one who won their state, a thing they're just allowed to do for some reason. Most states have rules against this, and this isn't something that's ever actually changed the outcome of an election, but it's still kind of weird to just have that possibility, you know? So that's how the system works, but what are the problems with it? Well, if you had the misfortune of being alive during the 2000 or 2016 elections, you already know the biggest one. The Electoral College makes it possible for a candidate to win the presidency while losing the popular vote. This has happened 5 times in US history, and has nearly happened several more. I would like to believe that this would be recognized as an obvious problem. However, in light of recent elections, a common talking point from Republicans in defense of the Electoral College is that it protects from the tyranny of the majority. Now, this isn't an argument that holds up under scrutiny. Tyranny of the majority is just democracy, the alternative presumably being tyranny of the minority, which I hope I don't have to explain why that is worse. But this is a defense not born out of genuine belief, but a cynical desire to win elections. We know this because, despite their recent support for the Electoral College following the elections of Bush and Trump, conservatives have opposed it in the past. President Richard Nixon supported an amendment in 1969 that would have abolished the Electoral College in favor of a popular vote. He and his Democratic opponent were both concerned about the possibility of third-party candidate George Wallace causing a tie, which would have sent the election to the House of Representatives, who are tasked with tiebreakers. This amendment easily passed in the House, but was ultimately killed in the Senate by filibuster, which is another insufferable quirk of American politics. Historically, pushes for Electoral College reform and/or abolition haven't been linked to any one party, and while it's primarily a Democratic policy at the moment, there's no reason that couldn't change in a couple decades or so. Another problem with the Electoral College is how it essentially renders millions of voters meaningless. The vast majority of states on election nights are considered safe states, states in which either party is almost certain to win. If you live in a safe state, your vote does not matter. On election day, the Democrat in Alabama and the Republican in California may as well leave their ballot blank. Their party has no chance of winning the state. But this system also hurts the Republican in Alabama and the Democrat in California, because under first-past-the-post, you only need a simple majority to win the state, Any additional votes after that majority don't matter. In the 2020 election, Joe Biden won 11 million votes in California to Donald Trump's 6 million. But he would have still won the state had he only gotten one more vote than Trump. This essentially renders the 5 million additional votes and the 6 million votes for Donald Trump irrelevant. Their voices were not heard in terms of the presidential election. Because the safe states are virtually a lock, elections under the Electoral College aren't even decided by all of the states, but instead just a couple of states that have the possibility of going either way, known as swing states. These states receive the vast majority of campaign visits and campaign spending because they're the only ones that really matter. And this is absolutely the least important problem with the Electoral College, but as a resident of Michigan, which is a swing state, I would love to have less presidential candidates come out here and pretend to care about cars to appeal to us. Yet another problem with this system is that people's votes are not weighted evenly. While the amount of electoral votes a state gets is partially based on population because the amount of representatives a state has is population-based, each state also has two additional electoral votes because of their senators. This means that in smaller states, there are fewer votes per electoral college vote than in larger states. In the most extreme case, the voting power of an individual in Wyoming carries 3.6 times the electoral power of an individual in California. In a country supposedly founded on the ideas of democracy and that all men are created equal, we continue to have an election system that is both undemocratic and unequal. Now, I think I've established fairly well how the Electoral College is bad for everyone. But I did promise at the outset that we would look at how elections in the US disadvantage African Americans in particular. So how do they? Well, African Americans are hit a lot harder by the first-past-the-post system because they are in the minority of the electorate in every state. Now, quick disclaimer. I am not saying all black people vote the same. People are individuals and make their own choices. In fact, this is part of the reason why if we had popular vote, the entire election would be controlled by a few big states argument is such a bad one. However, 92% of non-Hispanic black voters voted for Joe Biden in the 2020 election. And this has been a consistent trend ever since the mid-20th century and the Southern Strategy. But in some of the states with the highest black populations, you would never guess this. Mississippi, Louisiana, Georgia, Alabama, and the Carolinas all have a population that is at least 20% African American. No points for guessing why. But besides Georgia in 2020, these states are some of the safest for the Republican Party. Unlike a popular vote system, where while black people would still represent a minority of the electorate, their votes would actually count towards electing the president. We have a system where tens of millions of black voters have no impact on the election simply because of where they live. Okay, so the modern version of the Electoral College is pretty bad, both for America at large and African Americans in particular. But surely this is just a modern problem, right? It's not like it was designed to be this way, right? It's not like I'm just asking rhetorical questions to set up a transition to how, yes, it totally was screwed up from the start, right? In his book, Why Do We Still Have the Electoral College?, Harvard professor Alexander Kasar gives an account of how the Electoral College came to be. Now, I feel one of the most important things to understand about the founders is that they were all a bunch of incredibly stubborn dudes with wildly opposing ideas for how the country should be set up. Let's not forget the failed Articles of Confederation because they couldn't make it work the first time. So when it came to the electoral system, there were a lot of concerns. Slave states didn't want to lose power. Small states wanted to have power. A bunch of the founders just absolutely hated the idea of an actually democratic election. And so on. From this plethora of ideas, two main camps had formed. Those who supported a national popular vote, a group which included James Madison, and those who supported having the legislature pick the president, a group which presumably included some other dead guys. After they got tired of debating this over and over again, they decided to just delegate the job of making an electoral system to a committee. A week later, the committee had come up with what would become the Electoral College. This was seen as a compromise between the two sects, and while people had problems with it even before it was instated, they were largely more focused on squabbling about other stuff, so our electoral system just kind of flew under the radar. But there was one crucial caveat to the Electoral College. You see, prior to its creation, the founders had already made another compromise. Slave states wanted to have additional legislative power. Non-slave states did not want slave states to have additional legislative power, and thus was born the Three-Fifths Compromise. When counting a state's population for the purpose of allotting seats in the House of Representatives, enslaved people, who held no political power themselves, were counted as three-fifths of a person. This artificially increased the power of southern states in the legislature, as they would receive additional representatives because of their enslaved population. But you may remember that the Electoral College tallies a state's electoral votes based on that state's number of seats in Congress. So not only were slave states given additional legislative power, but also additional electoral power. Enslaved people, who held no voting rights, were being used to give more voting power to the very people that subjugated them, and the South ran with this power. Thomas Jefferson won the election of 1800 due to electoral votes attributable to counting enslaved people. It literally only took until the third president before the Three-Fifths Compromise was shaping American elections. These compromises made in the drafting of the Constitution are often argued to be not optimal, but necessary. We are told that had Southern states not been given undue political power with which to subjugate the people they enslaved, that the founders would never have been able to form a stable union. But the truth is that these compromises did not form a stable union. They never could. James Madison recognized this at the time, saying that
the great division of interests in the U.S. did not lie between the large and small states. It lay between the northern and southern.
And indeed, the division of interests led to decades of tension, culminating in the bloodiest war on U.S. soil. Following the war, there were three constitutional amendments that would transform the role of African Americans in politics. Amendment 13, which banned slavery except, crucially, as punishment for a crime. Amendment 14, which, among other things, made all people born in the U.S. citizens. And Amendment 15, which protects the right of people to vote regardless of race or if they'd previously been enslaved. With these amendments, you would expect the political freedom and power of African Americans to proliferate. They were no longer enslaved, their citizenship gave them the right to vote, and there could be no law explicitly banning them from doing so. And indeed, this period saw a wave of black politicians elected to office. But there's sort of a Newtonian law of politics, that whenever a minority group makes any political or social gain, they are met with resistance equal to or greater than their push for their rights. And the Reconstruction era saw resistance to black rights rivaling that of the Confederacy that had only just been dismantled. The first and most striking tool to limit black participation in elections was violence. This era saw the birth of the Ku Klux Klan, a white supremacist group which quickly rose to prominence across the South. They were essentially given a free pass to wreak terror upon the black population of the South, as little to no legal punishments would ever be faced by Klan members. During elections, Klan members would position themselves in front of the polling location, almost always armed with guns. This was an effort to intimidate black voters that was largely effective. As for any prospective voter who remained stalwart, well, the guns weren't just for show. J.L. Edmonds, a black Mississippi schoolteacher, described one instance of violence as such.
They had a parade at West Point. I was standing on the corner talking, and some of the colored men came up, and a colored man says, "I do not care how many are riding around. I'm a Republican and expect to vote the ticket." Just then, a man walked up with a pistol and shot him. Pretty soon, another colored man made some expression and he was shot at. They said they were going to beat at this election. They said at the meetings, on the stumps, and at schoolhouses around the county. They said they would carry the county or kill every They would carry it if they had to wade in blood.
And this was no empty threat. In Colfax, Louisiana, when a coalition of black and white voters came together to elect a slate of candidates, a group of white vigilantes murdered 100 people to overturn the election results. Knowing that a Southern jury would be unlikely to convict the killers for murder, this act of terrorism was taken to the Supreme Court as a civil rights issue. However, the court concluded that no civil rights violation had occurred. But there was another approach to blocking black voters, which was arguably even more effective than violence. The 15th Amendment prohibited restricting people's right to vote based on race. This, however, leaves a massive loophole to restrict the right to vote in other ways that target black voters while not explicitly saying so. This led to the creation of two main types of policies, poll taxes and literacy tests. With poll taxes, any person eligible to vote was required to pay a tax before they could cast a ballot, generally about a day's worth of pay. This disproportionately hurt prospective black voters because it turns out it's really hard to acquire the generational wealth necessary to afford these things when every generation before you were enslaved. But history shows that Americans are probably the most tax-opposed population on the planet. So why did white voters sign off on this? Well, racism, obviously. But they had also added in what's called a grandfather clause, where people who had ancestors that voted prior to the Civil War wouldn't have to pay the poll tax. This still left some white voters out of luck, however. And as you can probably guess, these clauses did not help any African Americans, because prior to the Civil War, slavery. Then there were literacy tests. On paper, these were simply tests of a prospective voter's ability to read and write in English. In practice, they were essentially impossible quizzes. Voting officials would be in charge of administering the tests and would routinely do so in a discriminatory manner. White voters may not have been forced to take the test at all, and when they did take it, they were typically given softball questions, like,
who is the president?
Black voters, on the other hand, were given intentionally difficult questions, such as,
if a state is a party to a case the Constitution provides the original jurisdiction shall be in.
Which is a question that, and this is true, nobody knows the answer to. If you think that you know the answer, you're wrong. And in Mississippi, some voters were even required to write an essay on the responsibilities of citizenship. And this is America. Nobody should ever have to write an essay. These tests would then be graded by those same voting officials who, because the entire system was left up to their discretion, could effectively just choose who passed and who failed regardless of the actual test. The combination of violence and disenfranchisement led to a sharp decline in political participation among black Americans. In the final decades of the 19th century, 23 black politicians were elected to the U.S. House and Senate. From 1900 up until 1929, there would be none. This situation created what some term the Five-Fifths Compromise, with black citizens now counting fully towards a state's House seats and electoral votes, but still lacking the ability to vote in practice. Combined with the already broken Electoral College, this created a situation where white voters in southern states had 4 to 10 times the voting power of white voters in northern states. Even having gained voting rights, most African Americans still served only to increase the political power of those subjugating them. The backlash against black voters was arguably the strongest around the 1920s. This was the second wave of the Ku Klux Klan. By now, the Klan had gained a significant foothold, even in the North, and counted its membership at 4 million people. That's more than the population of Los Angeles today. and this membership was pushed into political power. It's estimated that 16 senators, 75 representatives, and 11 governors were Klansmen in the 1920s. This second wave of the KKK was in part a response to the women's suffrage movement. The 19th Amendment prevented states from denying people their right to vote based on sex. This gave black women the right to vote on paper, but you may have noticed that, similar to the 15th Amendment, this does not actually guarantee any woman the right to vote, but instead merely prohibits discrimination based on sex. In Georgia, not a single woman was permitted to vote until the 1922 election because of their six-month registration deadline. In Daytona, the KKK marched on a girls' school before Election Day to scare women off from voting, although they came out to vote regardless, thanks to organizing by women's leader Mary McLeod Bethune. But around the nation, particularly in the South, the voting rights of women in color and African Americans as a whole were still bitterly resisted. By now, however, black Americans were better organized. The NAACP, founded by W.E.B. Du Bois, was the preeminent organization fighting for black voting rights at the time. They attempted this in a couple ways. Firstly, they brought the issue before Congress, where they gained little support, as Congress was draped in white hoods at the time. But they did increase public awareness on the matter. The NAACP did see some actual change, though. In Texas at the time, the Republican Party had little political power, so the only election that really mattered was the Democratic primary, from which black people were explicitly prohibited from participating. With the support of the NAACP, this rule was overturned by the Supreme Court in Nixon v. Herndon, and all-white primaries were eventually overturned completely in 1944 with the Smith v. Allwright ruling. These slow gains would continue, but the civil rights movement of the 1960s would lead to major victories. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 outlawed racial segregation, but the more important victories in regards to voting were the 24th Amendment, which banned poll taxes for federal elections, the Voting Rights Act of 1965, which banned literacy tests and allowed for better federal oversight of voter registration, and the 1966 Supreme Court case Harper v. Virginia Board of Elections, which banned poll taxes on the state and local level. And with these laws and rulings, racism was officially over in the United States.
Wait, hold up. Okay, I'm checking my notes and, well, this is just crap news. Apparently, it was not. Racism was not over. So, the civil rights movement saw a lot of progress. But as we've seen, there is no progress without pushback. When it became clear just how powerful black organizing could be in bringing about political change, it became clear to their opponents that in order to curb black rights, they would need to curb black organizing. The method they settled on was, much like the century prior, terror, this time enacted by the police. Former Nixon advisor John Ehrlichman said of the war on drugs,
"The Nixon campaign in 1968, and the Nixon White House after that, had two enemies, the anti-war left and black people. You understand what I'm saying? We knew we couldn't make it illegal to be either against the war or black. But by getting the public to associate hippies with marijuana and blacks with heroin, and then criminalizing both heavily, we could disrupt those communities. We could arrest their leaders, raid their homes, break up their meetings, and vilify them night after night on the evening news. Did we know we were lying about the drugs? Of course we did."
The increasingly militarized police force were given broad discretion to conduct no-knock raids, such as the one that killed Black Panther leader Fred Hampton. These efforts were depressingly effective and continue on today. And while the issue of black voting rights and police brutality are inextricably linked, if I got into police brutality, this video would never end.
So what limits to black voting rights exist today? Well, after reducing the influence of black organizing, by reducing the aliveness of black organizers, opponents to voting rights came up with some new ways to fight the black vote. One of these, which has actually been going on for a long time, is gerrymandering, a practice in which election districts are drawn to favor one party over another. The two primary methods used for gerrymandering are packing and cracking, where similar voters are either all put into the same district to reduce their influence, or spread out across a bunch of districts, so they never have a majority, thus also reducing their influence. For North Carolina's 2010 district map, they literally used a map of North Carolina's black population in order to draw the districts. Predictably, this reduced the impact of the black vote. But while drawing districts based on race is illegal, and this map did eventually get struck down, maps drawn with purely partisan data can have the same effect, as seen with North Carolina's current map. Another method is felony disenfranchisement, the practice in which the voting rights of people convicted of a felony are stripped away. This is decided on a state-by-state basis and can range from not being able to vote while in prison, to not being able to vote on parole, to not being able to vote even after your time is served. In Florida, the system for re-enfranchisement is so archaic that your voting rights could literally be up to whether or not the governor is feeling it on a given day. These laws weren't really a thing until after the civil rights movement, because before, they could count on other factors curbing the black vote. Now, this sucks for everyone, but it disproportionately sucks for African Americans, who, as a result of mass incarceration and the war on drugs, are disproportionately likely to be disenfranchised. 1 in 16 African American adults are disenfranchised. This rate is 3.7 times higher than that of all other groups. Here, we see the continuation of a 5/5 clause, as these disenfranchised are counted for their state's population, but still cannot vote. Proponents of these laws will typically go to the argument,
"Well, do you want murderers and terrorists to vote?"
But terrorists aren't exactly known for queuing up to vote at the school gymnasium. These laws aren't targeting violent killers. They're targeting people who had a couple ounces of crack on them 50 years ago. In a country where active politicians have committed far worse crimes, these people should not be losing their right to vote. Additionally, there's the practice of just making it more difficult to vote. Election Day is not a national holiday. Thus, many people who need to work face a lot more difficulty voting. This wouldn't be as big of an issue if there was easy access to mail-in and absentee voting. But conservatives, especially during and after the 2020 election, have been increasingly attacking the ability to vote absentee or by mail. Black churches have historically gone as groups on Sundays to vote early, but there have been attempts to end early voting on Sundays in some states. And when black voters do decide to vote in person, there are additional hurdles. Polling places in predominantly black areas are routinely shut down with little warning. And when African Americans can get to the polls, they typically face longer wait times than white voters. Voting is important, but hours waiting in line is a powerful disincentive. And when they finally get to the polls, there's the fourth leg of this racist table. Voter ID laws mostly sprang up before the 2012 elections, and currently 35 states have some form of them. In the harshest cases, there are laws that require prospective voters to present certain types of approved photo ID in order to cast their ballot. The main reasoning often given for having these laws is that they reduce election fraud. However, this seems to be an answer in search of a problem, as election fraud is a crime so rare, it might as well not exist.
A study of 2,068 alleged cases conducted by the News 21 Journalism Consortium found that since 2000, there have been only 10 cases of in-person voter fraud that could have been prevented by photo ID laws. 10 out of 146 million registered voters. That is a ratio of one case of voter fraud for every 14.6 million eligible voters.
Which is a ratio so self-evidently small, I don't even need to come up with some fun way to visualize it. So, the stated purpose of these voter ID laws doesn't seem to line up. But when we look at how the laws are structured and what their actual impact is, we can see why they're actually getting made. 11% of Americans, over 21 million people, don't have government-issued photo ID. But for African Americans, it's even worse, as 25% of them lack ID. And even for those who have ID, there's no guarantee that theirs will be accepted. Types of ID that are disproportionately held by African Americans are not accepted in the voter ID laws of some states, such as Wisconsin, North Carolina, and Texas, where they'll accept gun licenses, but not student IDs. The administration of these laws are also discriminatory. Non-white voters are more likely to be asked to present ID in order to vote. A frequent response to these facts is the argument that
they can just get IDs. What, are you saying black people are too stupid to get IDs? I need an ID to buy alcohol.
But this is generally obfuscation. It ignores the fact that these voter ID laws address a non-existent problem, so nobody should need to get an ID to vote in the first place, and it doesn't account for the difficulty incurred in getting photo ID. Around 7% of Americans don't have access to their proof of citizenship documents, which can make acquiring ID incredibly difficult. Not that it's easy for those who have their documents. The process to get a free ID can involve traveling long distances, waiting in long lines, and understanding a complicated legal process, which can be so difficult to navigate that many require legal assistance, which of course incurs additional expenses. It's a hard, expensive, and time-consuming process, which is the point. The harder it is to get an ID, the less likely someone is to vote. The century may have changed, but the tactics remain the same. Put up as many obstacles as possible. Make it as difficult to vote as you can manage, and millions won't. When looking at the entire history of African Americans and the US electorate, a few patterns emerge. First is that the very system of elections itself is designed in a manner that harms African Americans. Every obstacle to voting could be removed, and you'd still be left with the negative impact of the Electoral College and gerrymandering. No voting rights push can be fully effective without addressing these institutions. Secondly, those who opposed the voting rights of African Americans have always used loopholes to get around the amendments and laws protecting their votes. By not explicitly discriminating based on race, those who constructed these laws were able to effectively curb the ability of Black Americans to vote. But every single one of these laws has also barred some generally poorer and lesser educated whites from voting. Racist policies are bad for everybody. But since non-white people get hurt worse, far too many people are willing to sign off on them. Third, organizing is the most effective tool for promoting Black voting rights, and terror, the most effective tool for preventing it. There were no advancements of African American voting rights unless there was incredible amounts of organizing. From abolitionists in the Civil War, to coalitions built in Reconstruction, to the NAACP, to the Civil Rights Movement and Black Panthers, to modern organizing such as that of Black Lives Matter. But every one of these pushes have been met with violent force. From the KKK, from the police, and today from additional fascist street gangs besides just the police. The fight for voting rights faces massive resistance. Every advancement has been fought with dogged determination, both before and after it's happened. But every advancement has happened. The tale of the Black vote is a tale of resilience. No matter what has been done to them, African Americans continue the fight. The Klan killed thousands and kept Black politicians out of Congress for decades, but they couldn't keep them out for good. Not from the polls and not from Washington. Nixon's attempts to kill the Black Panthers may have ultimately been successful, but the legacy of the party lives on today, inspiring countless activists, including the largest civil rights movement in American history. However, successes, small and large, cannot become a reason for complacency. Knowing the history, it's doubtful that the fight for African American voting rights will ever truly be over. However, thanks to the resiliency of the movement and its people, there's one thing we can be sure of. While the fight may never be over, it will certainly never be lost.